We need to now move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 1302 in the name of Jackie Bailey on taking action on the NHS and ambulance crisis. Again, I invite members who want to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. Those joining us online to put an R in the chat function. And I call on Jackie Bailey to speak to and move the motion. Ms. Bailey, 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Don't get sick. Don't need an ambulance. And don't need A&E in SNP-run Scotland. Because in each of these areas, the government is letting you down. NHS staff, nurses, doctors and paramedics are all doing their very best, and they absolutely deserve our thanks. But they need more than warm words. They need action, and the SNP is not listening to their very real and genuine concerns. For months now, the Cabinet Secretary has done nothing. Ambulance delays were raised as an issue in the press in June and in July and in August. And where was the Cabinet Secretary in all that time? Posted missing, clearly hoping the problems would go away by themselves. But this is not new. Susan Donald from Aberdeenshire got in touch with me. Her father died on the 1st of January 2021, aged 81. He fell and broke his hip 3 days earlier. She called the GP practice at 6 p.m, then she called 111, and finally she was put through to the ambulance service call centre at 9 p.m. Despite this being an emergency, the ambulance did not arrive until almost 1 a.m. the following day, 7 hours after he fell. So this isn't a recent problem. This was happening 9 months ago. Ms. Donald raised issues, quite rightly, about coordination, about governance, but she's wondering why performance data available to senior management in health boards, in the ambulance service, and the Scottish Government did not raise flags about the problems months ago. So patients raise concerns. Health professionals raise concerns. Unite raised significant issues of concern. So did the GMB. A doctor described the service as third world. There were almost daily reports of problems. Where was the Cabinet Secretary? People had to die and for it to be on the front pages of national newspapers to shock this government into action. And that is shameful. Ambulance delays are the worst on record. But the ambulance delays have an underlying cause. The problem is patient flow through A&E and admissions to the hospital itself. If you want to fix problems with the ambulance service, you need to fix the blockage at A&E and create more beds. A&E waiting times are also the worst on record. The A&E waiting time target of 4 hours has not been met since it was introduced in 2012, 9 years ago. In the country's flagship hospital, the Queen Elizabeth, in the Cabinet Secretary's own constituency, I believe, only 44% of people were treated within that four-hour target. Ambulances are queued round the block, and the Red Cross have to provide humanitarian aid to the paramedics and their patients because they are waiting so long. Unite has suggested a turnaround time of 30 minutes for an ambulance to transfer a patient to A&E. We agree, and the Cabinet Secretary really must consider this seriously. And it's not just Glasgow that there is a problem. There's a problem in Edinburgh too, with only 52% of people being seen in 4 hours. It's so bad at the Edinburgh Royal Infirmary that a doctor there has described to me the hospital as, and I quote, a war zone, with elderly patients having intimate examinations carried out on trolleys in corridors without any privacy. Delayed discharge is also up by almost 50%. And with a significant number of COVID patients in hospital, there are simply not enough beds. And there is a growing crisis in social care that means care packages for people leaving hospital are just not available. Virtually every health board in Scotland has cancelled elective surgery. That's hundreds more people added to the almost 100,000 patients waiting for operations. They have even cancelled, Presiding Officer, cancer surgery at the Glasgow Royal Infirmary, confirmed to me by a consultant this morning. And all this is before winter pressures have even started. John Thompson of the Royal College of Emergency Medicine said that the NHS needed another 1,000 beds to cope with the crisis. Jamie McNamee, Unite convener at the Scottish Ambulance Service, agrees. And he went on to say that if things are to improve, then it must include field hospitals and other temporary admission units. Yet that was entirely missing from the Health Secretary's statement yesterday. So I would urge the Health Secretary, urgently consider temporary wards. Please consider field hospitals. We need that extra capacity, and we need to ask staff who have recently retired from the service to come back and to help out. Dr. Sue Robertson of the BMA told the Health Committee that without any realistic plans to increase the workforce in the short term gives us the perfect storm. So what urgent action is the government taking to deal with the crisis in the short term? And I know the government wants to blame all of these problems on the pandemic. And I agree that the pandemic has been really challenging for the NHS and for social care. But that is at best a partial excuse. This is what a paramedic had to say in the Daily Record this morning. I am fed up reading and hearing in the news that the pandemic is causing the problems with delays. It's true that it's a contributing factor, but this has been a disaster in the making for years. And he is absolutely right. Because since 2010, the SNP have cut 1,200 beds from the NHS in Scotland. In fact, they started cutting beds in 2007, the moment that Nicola Sturgeon became Health Minister. From 2007 to 2010, the SNP failed to pass on the money for health given to it by the UK government. That would have resulted in £1 billion more in spending today on the NHS. Let me remind you that Nicola Sturgeon was the Health Secretary for that entire period. And yes, it was Nicola Sturgeon too who cut the number of training places for nurses and doctors, despite being warned about the problems with staffing. This is a disaster that has been in the making for the last 14 years. And, Presiding Officer, the NHS is entirely devolved, not the responsibility of Westminster. The NHS in Scotland is run by the Scottish Government. There is no grievance to be manufactured here. There is nowhere for the SNP to hide. Please, this is a problem of their making. They need to listen to patients and staff, and they need to sort this now before it gets even worse over the winter. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Humza Yousaf to speak to and move Amendment 1302.3, up to 6 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to move the motion in my name. Presiding Officer, our National Health Service is under more pressure than it has ever been in its entire 73-year history. There's simply no denying that or getting away from that fact. The global pandemic is a crisis unlike any of us have ever witnessed. I suspect none of us will ever witness again in our lives. It took about 6 minutes for Ms Bailey to, of course, even mention the fact that there have been this biggest shock to the NHS in its 73-year history. Of course, I'll get away.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. If he is so confident that the crisis in our ambulances and in our A&Es is entirely down to the pandemic, will he commit to a government-led review of all deaths pertaining to the ambulance crisis, and will he make the publish the reviews of that so the Chamber can see them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I consider any good suggestion that comes from anywhere in this chamber. Let me say that I have never said that this is entirely down to the pandemic. In fact, yesterday I said very clearly that, of course, there were challenges in our NHS and our ambulance service beforehand, but it would be churlish and it would be inaccurate to not recognise the severe shock of the pandemic on our NHS. And it's not just about COVID patients. COVID patients, of course, at the moment are taking up about 1,100 beds, but it is about the accumulative impact. As I thought Dr. Beckett explained well on Good Morning Scotland today, is about accumulative impact of the pandemic. Those chronic patients that haven't been able to be seen in the last 18 months, therefore presenting with more complex issues and problems. To provide a little bit of context to today's debate, yesterday's Scottish Ambulance Service received 2,226 emergency calls, of which 1,580 required a response from an ambulance, and over 19% of these incidents were triaged as immediately life-threatening. Everyone involved at Scottish Ambulance Service is performing their duties under unprecedented pressure. I thank them once again for their continued efforts, and of course I've set out a number of proposals to support and improve staff well-being. As many members will know, the Scottish Ambulance Service website includes published board papers. Performance statistics are included within these papers, but I note calls from across the chamber that more information should be provided. And now seems an appropriate time to announce that the Scottish Ambulance Service will begin work on publishing performance data by Health Board on a more accessible part of their website, and this will be available soon and will ensure members are updated in that respect. Today's debate obviously comes on the heels of yesterday's announcement. I want to start by setting the record straight in relation to some of the other motions that have been brought forward, or amendments to the motion that have been brought forward. Not a single penny will be cut from the Scottish Ambulance Service's budget. In fact, we are increasing their budget by over 16% in this year alone, a £44 million increase on last year. In terms of some of the commitments I set out yesterday, I will just focus on two of them to give an update to the Chamber. I can now confirm, Presiding Officer, that deployment of Army personnel to support the Scottish Ambulance Service will begin from Sunday, with training commencing from Friday, and will in fact total 114 personnel for ambulance driver support. The increase was agreed yesterday afternoon by the Ministry of Defence, who make the decision on final numbers to support operational deployment. This deployment will come in three tranches, the first of which will be 27 drivers and 7 support staff. There will be further deployments on Monday and Wednesday, and all additional boots will be on the ground by the end of this month. I'd formally like to place on record my thanks to our armed forces, who in typical fashion have responded to our call with extreme urgency and pace. Yesterday I announced an additional £20 million of funding for the Scottish Ambulance Service, and I can confirm this money will be spent on a number of areas, including supporting our armed forces, as I've set out, supporting increased senior clinical decision making, facilitating additional community support where appropriate in terms of the Red Cross, and facilitating additional student capacity for support services as well. But all will be done where it's clinically safe. And this is where I wanted to address one or two of the points that Ms Bailey has raised. I will take suggestions from wherever they come in this chamber. I don't dismiss entirely out of hand the suggestion for a field hospital, but it will be important that, first of all, these options are clinically safe, but secondly, of course, that we have the workforce in order to be able to staff any such beds. But that is an option that is being explored. Of course, I'm happy to give way.
Thank you very much. I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for the intervention. They did, of course, create the NHS Louisa Jordan, so the staffing capacity must have been there for that.
Cabinet Secretary.
Sorry. Of course, at the beginning of the pandemic, the NHS was not fully remobilised. In fact, we'd stopped everything except urgent care and cancer care. So there was that heparin. No, not everything has stopped. That would be an inaccurate suggestion from Ms Bailey from a sedentary position. So we don't have that workforce. As she has rightly said, they are under pressure. To take them out of core sites and put them into, for example, a temporary structure would have an impact. I'm not ruling it out, I should say, to Ms Bailey. I'm just saying that there are implications, and it is perhaps not as simple as Ms Bailey is suggesting. In terms of the wider system pressure, I've spoken a lot about the Scottish Ambulance Service. I will return. I really am in my last minute.
The member is in his last minute.
I will be happy to take it in my closing speech and intervention from Douglas Ross. In fact, given that I'm in my last minute, I will return to the issues of wider pressures on the NHS, because Ms Bailey is absolutely correct, and our motion is correct to say that it is not just the ambulance service that is facing extreme challenges. This is a whole systems approach that we need to take, and the government will absolutely take. So our forthcoming winter plan will set out the measures that we and our partners will take to ensure that we can deliver high-quality, safe care in a sustainable way. And that will look at increasing the capacity, absolutely, and we will do that through urgent discussion. And we are having those urgent discussions with social care providers and local authorities. And we'll look at how we increase our capacity in relation to the workforce immediately as best we possibly can as well. We will also, as Ms Bailey asked in our opening contribution, look at how we can create temporary wards, for example, by repurposing some hospital space. And as to conclude, Presiding Officer, as I said yesterday, our ambulance service and NHS have been there when we have needed them the most. In turn, this government will support our NHS during its greatest hour of need. I look forward to today's debate and move the motion in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Sandesh Gilhani to speak to and move Amendment 1302.2.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all know the stats by now. the worst A&E waiting times on record, 1,000 acute beds short ahead of winter. The fire brigade, taxi drivers and our British army called in to help. The Louisa Jordan Field Hospital closed. All as our NHS faces its hardest winter in living memory. Yesterday, the SNP Green government announced finally that they accepted our NHS and our ambulance service are in crisis. Today, we called for concerted, well-thought-out action. Cabinet Secretary, the days of knee-jerk responses must be over. Of course, at this late stage, the challenge is indeed huge. So today, I want to help the Cabinet Secretary by providing some advice and also provide some of the key questions that I'll expect answers to when I read his forthcoming winter action plan. I'm not patronising when I say this. It's simply that our NHS and ambulance services are in crisis under the SNP's watch. Let's start with data. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary announcing just now ambulance response times, but please can we ensure that this is weekly? If this data is published weekly, it means we can keep track of what's happening on the ground and fine-tune the plans where necessary. Data also provides us with lessons, so planning and resourcing mistakes can be avoided in future. If you don't measure, you can't improve. I'm calling on this because I want to help. I want to advise. I don't want to see problems spinning out of control. Speaking as a doctor, we know that early intervention is key to treating a disease, and the same goes for managing policy in a crisis. Our ambulance service is under enormous pressure with regards to the valuable assistance of the police, the fire service, taxi firms, and our British Army. We also need transparency over the scale of the crisis support. From week to week, we need to evaluate how much we depend on this support, how long will we need this support, and what lessons we can learn to take forward for NHS planning. Processes and procedures are also important. What exactly is it the government is asking the fire department or taxi firms to do? Are the processes and pathways in place for this external support? Can we see these? How are the Scottish Government going to evaluate the work of the fire department, taxi firms, our British Army, and any police support? What are the government's target response times for ambulance and taxis? As for taxis, how can the Cabinet Secretary ensure the safety of drivers and passenger patients? There's still a lot of COVID out there. Also, has the Scottish Government started the Disclosure Scotland process for these drivers yet? The action plan for the NHS and ambulance service also won't be a credible plan without joined up thinking across services and departments regarding workforce planning. In order to help, we need to see this. In a crisis, plans may need to be adapted as the data informs us or the reality on the ground, but we need a well thought out blueprint in the first place. This requires details of clinical pathways. NHS staff and indeed Scottish people need to know the patient journey. Given the reality on the ground with staffing levels, patient waiting times, cancelled operations and winter fast approaching, what can patients expect? How will the patient journey evolve? What will need to be changed? We need clarity over this and we need to communicate clearly with staff and patients. Finally, let's consider pop-up wards. Just as the failure to plan and maintain stocks of PPE over the years exposed clinical staff and patients to danger during the pandemic, the decision to close the Louisa Jordan Field Hospital is coming back to haunt us. What an example of poor planning and waste. We need to act now to establish pop-up wards at hospitals, but a word of warning, these should not be used to fudge A&E waiting time stats. If patients are waiting in a ward to be seen, that's what's happening. They're waiting, of course.
The member is in his last minute. Okay.
Will the Cabinet Secretary commit to maintaining the four-hour A&E treatment target, regardless of the emergency care setting? Provide details on workforce planning, clinical pathways and temporary facilities. Provide weekly reports on external support provided to the NHS and ambulance service. Cabinet Secretary, there have been five SNP ministers in charge of health, a straight line of Cabinet Secretaries since Nicola Sturgeon, who held the position from 2007 until 2012. We're in a crisis. Please act. I would like to move the amendment in my name and declaration of interest. I am a practicing doctor.
Thank you. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton, up to 4 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I would like to thank the Labour Party for choosing to devote some of their parliamentary time to this issue. The Labour Party are correct in saying that the government has failed, because it has. They have failed Gerard Brown, Catherine White, Lillian Briggs and many others who have been forced to wait hours for help whilst in agonising pain, often unable to access food or water or even go to the toilet. For those not as directly involved in politics as all of us in this chamber, the stories that broke last week in the Daily Record will have come as a great shock. Sadly, this crisis, however, has been on the cards for a long time. In the summer of 2016, a Scottish Liberal Democrat Freedom of Information request revealed figures that showed just how much pressure the ambulance service was under. In the year 15-16, the Scottish Government target to respond to serious incidents in under 8 minutes was missed over 51,000 times. In Glasgow, the number of patients facing waits of 20 minutes or more almost trebled from 80 to 233. In Aberdeen, the number rose from 16 to 40. The warning lights have literally been there for years, yet this government still has the audacity to blame the pandemic in large part for their own failures. 2 weeks ago, after I lodged an urgent question on A&E waiting times, the Health Secretary told me I needed to ground myself in reality. So let me take this opportunity, Presiding Officer, to lay out for the Health Secretary what that reality looks like. The reality is this. It is one in patients in pain waiting over a year for treatment. It's nearly 8,000 patients waiting more than 4 hours to be seen in our A&E departments. It is the 8,356 ambulance staff working days lost due to mental ill health related reasons in 2020 alone. And it is Gerard Brown losing his life because he waited 40 hours for an ambulance. While the Health Secretary dances around scrutiny on this, berating anyone who dares to hold him and his government to account, people are hurting and people are dying. Granular improvements are not good enough. These delays are not the result of the pandemic alone and are certainly not the fault of members of the public who call for emergency care in desperation. They are a symptom of an overrun and understaffed healthcare service, ignored for too long by a government putting priorities elsewhere. If resources are not offered up soon, staff will leave and the NHS will be in even more trouble. Last year, my colleague Liam MacArthur led the campaign to pay student paramedics. And in October 2020, where the former Minister of Public Health, Joe Fitzpatrick, said he agreed with the principal but couldn't agree to a bursary. That was until the election, when the polls indicated the SNP had to do something. It is too little, too late. This ambulance waiting times crisis didn't come out of nowhere. It is the result of failure after failure at the hands of this government. The unimaginable pressure, Presiding Officer, our health service is under now is scarring a generation of healthcare professionals. Staff are struggling and are fighting against impossible workloads. The Health Secretary failed to provide any light at the end of the tunnel with his NHS recovery plan. It was a bundle of repackaged announcements, most of which won't take effect until years down the line. And nothing in his statement yesterday reassured the public or this parliament that things will get better. Staff, patients and their families don't just deserve more from this government, their health actively depends on it. So I close by reiterating my call to the government, Presiding Officer. If the Health Secretary is content and confident that this is purely an aberration of the pandemic, then let him conduct a review into waiting times. Let him conduct into reviews, like the death of Gerard Brown, as to why these deaths happened. And if he is confident in those statistics and those results, let him publish them to this chamber and to the public that are watching this ambulance waiting times crisis. We're happy to support the Labour Party this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate, and I call Carol Mockin to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We go through a lot of motions in this chamber thanking various workers and groups for their efforts. And whilst that has a place in what we should be doing here, the weight of the crisis affecting ambulance availability and the subsequent stress caused to patients and frontline workers should hold greater weight than usual. So whilst I applaud all of our dedicated staff, I really think my time is better used trying to find out why this government keeps letting them down. My standing here and telling paramedics, call responders and technicians how thankful we are for their work will make no difference if in a year's time I'm back here doing exactly the same, whilst an unresponsive government continues to make excuses for the problems. We cannot change processes, adjust targets and rebrand services and call that reform. It isn't. It's a branding exercise and it is not responsible governance. The key to all of this is simple. The ambulance service is underfunded, understaffed and lacking in resources. Fix that and you fix the problem. I cannot stress enough to this government that chasing targets and small headline improvements over proactive structural reform is not the way to run a health service. So it's disappointing that this week the Health Secretary should be wasting his time briefing the Daily Record on his statement before he informs the Chamber. Doing so only further ingrains this image that it's all about expectation management and public presentation. I do not want to manage the expectations of the woman who was left lying in the Airtown Centre for 4 hours last month waiting on an ambulance. I want her to be treated and back home with her family. And that is not even one of the most extreme examples. When you have reports of patients waiting over 40 hours for an ambulance, it creates anxiety and stress throughout many communities who are well aware a delay in them making it to hospital could be the difference, as we know, between life and death. At least there is some positive news this week, perhaps COVID rates seemingly declining across Scotland, and I believe we should use any breathing space that allows us to focus all our efforts on preparing the NHS for the coming winter and alleviating pressure on the worst impacted parts of our hospitals. Yet instead of doing this, we may have to pick up the pieces of the missteps that have been taken over the last couple of years. As my party colleagues and others have mentioned, there's a concerning clinical backlog that needs to be addressed right now, and it requires new field hospitals to tackle that. Then that is exactly what we should be doing. I understand and have heard the Health Secretary has not ruled that out, and I would certainly support any steps to achieve that goal. Regardless of how it is reported, it is important for patients and the communities. Before I close, let me reiterate that all of these problems, queues of ambulances, lack of beds, overworked staff, are all deeply interconnected, and we cannot tackle them without addressing the problem of underfunding. The government have committed £1 billion of investment over the next 5 years to the NHS, and some of that has gone towards training and recruiting new staff, but that will take almost a decade to bear fruit. In fact, nearly all of the funding was already earmarked before May, with a fair amount of previous commitments already shelved. That is not going to be enough. The NHS needs emergency measures now to cope, and I think we can see from the feelings in this chamber that reports coming back from our constituents suggest that the public need action too. After that, we need to address the problem of long-term planning and failing to bring in the resources the NHS require well ahead of time. This chamber should be dealing with the difficult issues, and whatever works for the NHS, we should be pursuing. That is reflected in the strength of the Scottish Labour's motion, and I hope it will be supported in that spirit. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to start by reiterating that the Scottish Ambulance Service is the heartbeat of our NHS. There is no service like it. Providing emergency care for the public 24 hours a day, every day, our ambulance service have a unique and challenging job, and I want to place in record my thanks to paramedics and others who make sure this service is available to those who need it, not just during this dreadful pandemic, but always. And as the Cabinet Secretary said, there's no way ignoring the strain that the pandemic has put on our services. We're in a crisis, and despite restrictions lifting and some aspects of daily life feeling a little more normal for many of us, that strain on the NHS is still very much there. COVID has not gone away, and there's no denying that the ambulance service is under immense pressure with demand unusually high. Our emergency departments are busier than ever with complex cases, and just last month there were over 10,000 life-threatening incidents responded to, double that of in 2018. And yes, also, as others from other benches in the Chamber have said, we have to accept that the pressure on the ambulance service predates the pandemic. The fact that anyone is having to wait these reported amount of times for an ambulance is completely unacceptable. And I too have had contact from constituents facing unacceptable waits and have taken up their cases where appropriate, as MSPs from all parties, government parties and opposition parties, would be expected to do. And I welcome the announcement from the Cabinet Secretary yesterday in his statement, and I'm glad that we have recognised that this unacceptable place that we're in, and we're now taking swift and appropriate action to help ease the pressure. And I think the pressure needs to be looked at on the round. I think a lot of the debate today has been about, you know, a criticism of the government and the government only. But I think back to a case which was pre-pandemic, where an individual in my constituency waited for a long time for an ambulance. I can't remember the number of hours, but it was certainly hours. And it was because she had slipped on the ice because of cutbacks to gritting. So I think we need to look at all these things in the round. How can government improve the situation? How can local authorities improve the situation? And what I think people in the public won't expect is for us to be speaking constructively about that. I'm not going to have time, unless I get time back, Presiding Officer.
There is about 2 minutes in hand to the end of the debate, but as you're not on your last minute, it is up to you, Mr McGregor.
Okay, I will take the intervention.
Paul O'Kane.
I thank the member for giving way, and I think, you know, he's making a speech that acknowledges, I think, the scale of the crisis and indeed the issues that existed pre-pandemic. And he made the point there about the issue with the ICE, but would he accept that cutting local government funding and budgets contributes to the wider problems we have in the health service, and that has a knock-on effect? So we have to appropriately fund local government to be able to deliver these services.
Fulton McGregor.
Well, I don't accept the characterisation, and local governments have their own decisions to make, and the local government in North Lanarkshire, as the member might be aware, is a Labour and Conservative coalition, so they have those decisions to make. The point I was trying to make, though, to the member, was not to get in a political bun fight there about, you know, what Labour might be doing in North Lanarkshire and what the SNP are doing at Holyrood. It was to say that these things need to be looked at on the round. It's a systems approach, and I would hope that the member would actually agree with that, that we need a systems approach, that everything interacts with each other. I wholeheartedly welcome the additional £20 million that will be invested into the ambulance service that was announced yesterday, Presiding Officer. I believe this will allow extra personnel to ensure our services can continue to operate and ultimately make sure that sick patients are able to be met with and helped in a timeous manner. And it's good to hear that we're pulling resources from our military, paramedic students, Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, British Red Cross, amongst others. And on the issue of student paramedics, of course, the Scottish Government, as Alex Cole-Hamilton has mentioned, recently implemented the £10,000 bursary scheme, which a lot of the work and credit does go to Liam MacArthur. But I also want to give some credit to Holly Carragher from my constituency, who personally lobbied me and the First Minister on this issue, so maybe to let Alex Cole-Hamilton know.
If you could please wind up, Mr McGregor.
Wider society that also successfully lobbied on this issue. I'm sorry, Presiding Officer, I thought I was 2 minutes. I could get 2 minutes back now.
No, it's 4 minutes this afternoon.
Oh, right, OK. I'm sorry, I've picked you up wrong there. And in that case, then, I will end, Presiding Officer, by saying that I support the government amendment today. Thank you.
I call Megan Gallagher to be followed by James Dornan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yesterday, the First Minister finally admitted that our NHS is in crisis. This was only after growing pressures from NHS health boards, healthcare professionals, unions and MSPs who warned this government that if they did not act, they would push our NHS beyond breaking point. The Scottish Conservatives have repeatedly warned the government that our NHS was at breaking point long before the First Minister's admission. A&E waiting times, ambulance waiting times, the cervical cancer screening scandal, waiting lists for vital diagnostic tests, CAMHS waiting lists. These are just some of the issues which have been raised in this chamber, and it's clear that after 13 years in government, the SNP do not have the willingness or the ability to fix the problems that they have created. Presiding Officer, it is clear that the crisis is one that was entirely preventable. However, due to the length of time taken for the SNP to act, these long-standing pre-COVID issues have now been exacerbated by the impact of the pandemic. Further to the announcement from the Cabinet Secretary yesterday, more than 100 military personnel will be drafted in, providing much-needed assistance to our hard-working NHS staff. Now, as we've heard this morning, Taxi drivers will be recruited to help transport patients to hospitals for appointments. This is the same taxi drivers which were left hung out to dry during lockdown by this SNP government. In my own region, NHS Lanarkshire will benefit from the services provided by staff being deployed by the British Army, Fire Brigade and Taxi Services. This assistance will provide a welcomed relief to my constituents and frontline staff at NHS Lanarkshire. However, we should never have ended up in this position in the first place. We have heard the devastating news over the last few weeks of people dying due to the length of time they've had to wait to receive urgent care. We have heard of elderly people who lay on the floor in agony whilst hoping that someone would come and help them. We have had people waiting for hours on end at A&E and others turning up to hospitals because they can't see their GP face to face as they are so overworked and so overwhelmed. Cabinet Secretary, all of these situations took place under your watch and it can never be allowed to happen again. The Scottish Government had every opportunity to intervene to fix these issues, but instead we had the Health Secretary telling people to think twice before calling an ambulance. Will the Cabinet Secretary finally apologise for this, or will he continue to dismiss the notion that what he said was reckless and irresponsible? Presiding Officer, the amendment submitted by the SNP doesn't even begin to address the immense issues that our heroic NHS staff have had to endure, and quite frankly, they should be ashamed. The Scottish Conservatives will vote against this amendment today and instead will vote for a position which will force the SNP to declare a major incident status within our ambulance service, halt planned efficiency savings by the SNP government, maintain the four-hour A&E treatment target and for the government to publish a weekly ambulance response time data so that progress can be measured in every region. Presiding Officer, I agree with the points raised in the Labour motion, especially the recognition that they give to the wonderful Scottish Ambulance Service paramedics, technicians, call handlers and other frontline workers who have been failed by this government. It is only right that we continue to support our NHS heroes who are always on hand to respond to an emergency. I therefore urge Labour to vote for our amendment to their motion tonight to recognise our hard-working NHS staff, but to also ensure that this Scottish Government is held to account over the NHS crisis they have created.
Thank you. I call James Dornan to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Firstly, like everybody else, I'd like to pay tribute to the incredible hard-working staff of the Scottish Ambulance Service. They are without a doubt the people at the sharp end of our health service provision and deal with some of the most serious situations we'll ever face in life in a professional and in caring manner. They see things that would make most of us blanch, and they still save countless lives each and every day as part of their jobs. However, I think it's important our admiration for the work they do isn't tarnished by the negative attention they've been receiving lately, including this afternoon from media and politicians alike. You may prefix your attack by telling them how much you admire them, but what the NHS worker hears when you continually criticise the part of the service they're working in is, you're hopeless. We all know that's unfair and untrue, and I'm sure that's not what you want them to think. Now, I understand it's the job of politicians to raise the concern of their constituents and oppose the government, but the Conservative debate last week in GPs and the Labour one today in the Scottish Ambulance Service is beginning to look like a coordinated political attack on our health service as it tries to deal with the effects of both a pandemic that none of us saw coming and a Brexit that slashed the number of workers in the health and social care. So at least with Jackie Bailey, she's always pretty upfront. You know, she'll use any chance to have a go at the SNP, Health Secretary and the First Minister. And I'm pretty sure the official record will show that she mentioned the FM more often than she mentioned the pandemic. Today, we've heard two debates from Labour on two very important issues, rail and ambulance. Labour's solution to both appears to be to spend money that we simply just don't have. There is no money tree out in the parliamentary garden, and that is not real politics. That's student politics. There are real issues to be dealt with here, and they must be dealt with. But this unwillingness by any of our opponents to accept that a serious factor in all this is the pandemic doesn't serve anybody any good. I was pleased by the announcement yesterday by the Cabinet Secretary for Health that the volunteer drivers from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service will be drafted in to assist the ambulance service, and that from this weekend, the Army will be helping. or as the Conservatives continue to call it, the British Army will be helping in order to take some of the pressure off. This is very welcome news, and I'm hopeful this will at least begin to address some of the problems we've experienced. The 100 trainee paramedics, who will be tasked with call handling as well, will help to alleviate some of the backlog the increased level of calls is calling. It's a difficult situation, and it's one that's obviously worrying to the public and one that's not easily resolved. But remember, this is a situation without precedent in Scotland or the UK, and we are not alone in dealing with these problems. 4 out of 10 ambulance trusts in England are using army personnel to help deal with the situation. I echo the appeals of the Health Secretary, and I agree with him wholeheartedly about this. Members of the public should only ask for an ambulance if they believe the situation is life-threatening. Particularly just now, in all other circumstances, please phone NHS 24 and 111. If they believe that an ambulance is necessary after talking to you about the situation, one will still be dispatched, even though you haven't called 999. And I know this because it's happened in my own house. This is advice being given all over the UK as well in Scotland, and it's important that we adhere to it in order to reduce the waiting time for the most serious cases. I'm not sure there's a quick fix to this, and I know it's not for the want of trying on the part of our dedicated health professionals across the ambulance service and the NHS and social care in Scotland. But remember, Brexit has stopped a lot of the workers who used to work in social care in Scotland from coming over here, and that is having a huge impact on the ability to get the beds emptied in the hospital and get people back into the community. I appeal to my colleagues from all parties across the chamber, pull together and give all of our support to those people who are working so hard to battle the pandemic and to keep our citizens alive in the most demanding of circumstances, and to stop seeing them as a weapon to be used in a political battle. They deserve much more than that. Thank you.
I call Julian Mackay to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too would like to thank our ambulance crews and indeed all those working in emergency care and the wider NHS for continuing to work extremely hard in very difficult conditions. The stories of extremely long waiting times for ambulances make for distressing reading, and I can't imagine the distress felt by the people who have faced these agonising waits. I'm grateful for the measures set out yesterday by the Cabinet Secretary, and I hope they begin to make an impact quickly. Ambulance crews are working incredibly hard to reach people who need help as quickly as possible, but demand is simply outstripping supply. The pandemic has meant staff have been working flat out for 18 months with no respite, and I'm extremely concerned about the impact on their mental and physical health. There have been disturbing reports of crews being unable to access food, water or rest for whole shifts. How can we expect them to care for us when they have no time to care for themselves? We need to protect ambulance service staff as well, as people become frustrated with long waits. Staff will inevitably bear the brunt of this. I welcome that the Scottish Government has announced additional wellbeing support, but we also need strong messaging that abuse or intimidation of ambulance crews is not acceptable. There have also been reports of call handlers receiving abuse due to long waits, and I would be grateful if the Cabinet Secretary could confirm whether there will be additional wellbeing support put in place and extended to ambulance crews and other staff. Extra clinical capacity will no doubt relieve some of the pressure being placed on teams, and I'm extremely grateful to the 100 second-year students who will be working across the ambulance service while carrying out their studies. They should rightfully be applauded. I do have concerns, however, about the impact this will have on their studies and the potential risk of burnout. And I ask the Cabinet Secretary to confirm that no students will be academically disadvantaged and that they will receive wellbeing support. The demand for ambulances will undoubtedly place pressure on other emergency and out-of-hours services, and I'm concerned about the secondary impact of long waits on NHS 24 and out-of-hours general practice. We must ensure that they are properly supported to meet a potential surge in demand. Likewise, delayed discharge is placing pressure on hospital wards, A&E departments and the ambulance service, as patients occupying hospital beds cannot be discharged without a care package. We need to take a whole system approach when looking at how we can relieve pressure, and Dr. Daniel Beckett, an acute care consultant, has spoken in the media today about the fact that if we're able to meet patients' social care needs, then patients can move out of hospitals, which would in turn reduce crowding in wards and emergency departments, as well as reduce ambulance delays. The National Care Service is, of course, the long-term goal of this Parliament, but social care needs support now. I've previously spoken about the need for a social care recovery plan, and I urge the Government to give serious consideration to this. While a whole system approach is vital, we must also respond to acute pressure points in the system. NHS Forth Valley within my region is currently the worst performing health board in terms of the four-hour A&E target. Nationally, 71.5% of patients are being seen within 4 hours, while in Forth Valley it's just 53.4%. That's a significant difference, and I'd be grateful to hear from the Cabinet Secretary if they're considering targeted interventions for Forth Valley. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we must prioritise staff welfare. Our dedicated NHS workers continually go above and beyond, but that should never be taken for granted. Clapping on the doorsteps is not enough when paramedics cannot access food and water throughout a 12-hour shift. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Claire Adamson to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And like many calls this afternoon, I want to add my thanks to those working in our health services, in our emergency services and our Scottish Ambulance Service, paramedics, technicians, call handlers and other frontline workers. They are under a significant stress, and we know what the pressures are at the moment. However, I am somewhat disappointed to be returning to a debate this afternoon which seems to be based on arbitrary requests and not really looking at the systemic issues and supporting the government in what they are trying to do to tackle these issues. Last week in the year, we had a call for GP services to return to normal, and I quote, normal face-to-face at a set date. No, thank you. At set date in time, it was an arbitrary request and it will do nothing to help the situation we're in at the moment. And despite Jackie Bailey in very well talking about the issues and the systemic issues and all the points at which there are pressures in our health service at the moment, including in social care and getting people into social care and out of hospitals, the motion before us, the ask is that we set a 30-minute maximum turnaround time for ambulances arriving at the hospital. Again, words that won't really address this problem at all, just arbitrary words for the debate. And no, thank you. So, the tone of the debate is about everything rests on this government and the management of the health service on this government alone. If we look to Wales, the BBC reported today that the morale of the ambulance service in Wales is at rock bottom, 57% increase in calls in July this year. Mark Drakeford requesting support and from the army because of the pressures that are up. Our treatment times are under pressure, and areas outside hospitals, again, are under pressure as well. And that's why what I've heard from this health service is not a denial of where we are, not a denial that there are problems, not a denial that anyone who has lost their life or has had to wait for an unacceptable time, they have never said that that's acceptable. It's not. But what I do hear from them is that we have to do something to work on these areas, these pinch points, such as investigating whether they can open up more admission wards in hospitals, whether they can look at a pop-up solution. And to say that this is just on this government is completely ignoring the situation in the wider UK, where all governments are under the same pressures. We've talked about the shortage in doctors and the
colleagues,
services.
Ms. Adamson, can I just have 1 minute, please? There are a lot of sedentary comments coming from across the chamber. I'd be very grateful if we could hear Ms. Adamson. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've obviously touched a raw nerve. People don't want to hear that this is a broader issue than just Scotland. Hundreds of paramedic students will now receive a bursary, as mentioned by my colleague Fulton McGregor. The Daily Mail recorded that there are 50,000 vacancies for doctors in England in the health service. These are pressures we are all experiencing. And that's why today I want to highlight what this government is doing. We should all get behind them to help our health service So the additional investments announced, the £20 million have been invested in the Scottish Ambulance Service to improve response times and alleviate pressures and improve staff wellbeing. We need to get behind them. We need to train more paramedics. I'm very glad that we've paid double the bursary that they do in England to our paramedics and nurses training. And we need to get behind the work that the Cabinet Secretary is doing. And we're listening to the Scottish Ambulance Service. We are listening to these calls. And we're investigating where the pressures are. And with a government with Fair Work at its heart, we know that they'll be looking to the wellbeing of our workforce going forward. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My constituent, Susanna Jackson, who had previously suffered a stroke, had a bad fall at home. An ambulance was called at 5:30 p.m. It didn't arrive until 10:30 that evening. She was worried and in pain. She was taken to Edinburgh's Royal Infirmary, where she had to wait in the corridor on a trolley before finally being seen at 5:45 the next morning. The staff said Monday nights are always bad. And this is no isolated incident. My elderly constituent, Helen Fraser, is a local community champion. She recently led a street-to-street campaign against the builders' merchants in a residential area of Haddington. And against the odds, she won. Helen is a fighter. She is not one to complain. But last week, she sent me this email about her husband's treatment in the hands of the SNP government. The letter opened. Dear Craig, as you know, Ian is terminally ill. Over the weekend, he developed a further problem, which caused great pain, and our GP attended to him at home yesterday. The doctor said Ian needed an X-ray and arranged for an ambulance to the Western General. The GP mentioned the current ongoing delays of hours and said if things get worse, dial 999. Helen reports that the ambulance service logged the instruction on Monday at 1:45 p.m. Around 6 p.m, she got a call saying Ian was in the system and to apologise for the delay. But the operator could not indicate when an ambulance might arrive. A further call came at 9 p.m, again with the same message. Then another call on Tuesday morning at 1:15, then 3:15, and another at roughly 6 a.m. Helen says the calls were all the same apart from one with a nurse who asked more questions. On the last call, Helen asked if she could change to 999. She was told that the wait for emergency vehicles was bad. It would take hours. Ian would have to be triaged again, and that they simply did not have enough vehicles. Helen said it was impossible to sleep. She finally decided that she would use a taxi and try to cancel the ambulance by using the incoming number, but that would not accept incoming calls. So she called the Western General Hospital and asked for a message to be passed to say that she and Ian were still coming in. Helen asked if the ambulance could be cancelled, but the person she spoke to said she would not be able to do that. When the receptionist at the hospital finally booked Ian into the Western, she agreed to cancel the ambulance. But, says Helen, after she got home later in the day, a neighbour mentioned that an ambulance had been at the door at 8:30 a.m, 19 hours after it had first been ordered. Helen adds, "I really hope that no one thinks we left home without consideration of the consequences." In her email, Helen Fraser speaks for many. She says the NHS is in a complete shambles. Helen says, and I quote, "There is no blame whatsoever to be attached to the hard-working staff and our medics and our nurses. The problem lies squarely with the incompetence of the Scottish Government. No amount of blaming Westminster," she says, "or Boris Johnson or COVID can cover up these statistics. Ours," says Helen, "is just one case, but how many other patients are being caught up in this ongoing catastrophe?" Presiding Officer, Ian Fraser deserved to be treated with dignity, but under this SNP government, his urgent needs were disregarded. For Helen and Ian Fraser's sake, and the sake of thousands of Scots caught up in this unfolding catastrophe, the Minister must now get a grip of this crisis.
Thank you. We now move to closing speeches, and I call on Sue Webber. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Webber.
Sorry, Presiding Officer, that's just caught me a bit there because I've welled up a bit with that. So thank you very much, Presiding Officer. We've heard today how our ambulance service is at breaking point. and there can be no doubt that the Scottish NHS is in crisis, and the SNP are to blame, not the pandemic. The SNP have ignored the warning signs for years, and as Jackie Bailey outlined earlier, all the stakeholders' concerns have been ignored – unions, patients, healthcare professionals – resulting in unnecessary deaths. These are systemic failures, not pinch points, as Claire Adamson pointed out. I'd like to reiterate that. And the SNP have dithered and have taken far too long to respond to this crisis. Action must be taken. The Scottish Conservatives are calling on the SNP to provide an emergency funding package and publish a detailed strategy to maximise the use of military staff to tackle this crisis. And every day we read about cases of long waits for ambulances, sometimes leading to needless deaths, and some heartbreaking stories that we've heard just then from my colleague Craig Hoy. The Scottish Government has requested support from the British Army, yes, the British Army, in tackling Scotland's ambulance crisis. And while we welcome this request being made, it should have happened already, and it just exposes the SNP's shambolic handling of Scotland's health service. In addition, firefighters and taxi services have now been drafted in to help the Scottish Ambulance Service. However, even after Hamza Yousaf's statement to Parliament yesterday, the Unite Union warned that drafting in the army and firefighters as drivers will not be enough to cope with the crisis. And my colleague Megan Gallagher also highlighted the hypocrisy from the Cabinet Secretary that taxi drivers will now be recruited to help transport patients to hospital for their appointments. These very same taxi drivers which were left hung out to dry during lockdown. The pandemic has exposed the many weaknesses that are deep-rooted. They've all existed in our health service for some very long time due to the SNP's mismanagement, long before we heard of COVID. And the deep-rooted workforce crisis was mentioned by Mr Cole Hamilton in his contribution today as well. Our healthcare professionals have worked in these extreme conditions for years, juggling staff and equipment shortages just to keep patient services going. While there has rightly been a focus on tackling COVID within our health service, other illnesses and diseases cannot simply be forgotten about. The number of excess deaths that are occurring in Scotland are tragic, and my thoughts are with those who have lost a loved one. And yesterday, Nicola Sturgeon finally admitted that the NHS is in crisis. Yet Ms Sturgeon and Mr Yousaf would not confirm when an NHS winter plan would be published. It should have formed an integral part of any NHS Scotland remobilisation plan, yet it has not. We are calling on the SNP Green Government to shelve the plans for £15 million in efficiency savings. That's not the same as cuts. They've been requested to make efficiency savings, and instead announce a series of actions to tackle the crisis, including an emergency funding package that focuses on saving lives. The SNP need to develop a real plan of action to fully remobilise our NHS, fund our ambulance service properly and bring waiting times back under control. Although this will be a challenge for the SNP, as it's about time we got some detail and not just soundbites. The Scottish Conservatives will vote against this SNP amendment today, and I would urge Labour to vote for our amendment that lays down some of the questions that we need answers to be asked by the Scottish Government. We need to further strengthen the original motion presented by Jackie Bailey this afternoon. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call on Hamza Yousaf. Up to 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Sometimes, in these debates, there can often be more heat than light, but I'm pleased there have been some helpful suggestions. Not everything, of course, that was said I would agree with, but I'm going to try to take as many of the members' contributions and questions that were asked as possible. So we've heard a number of calls today to thank Scottish Ambulance Service staff. We've heard a number of calls to provide additional investment, to get support from the armed services, to protect staff welfare, to increase the workforce by encouraging recently retired workers to temporarily return to the NHS. This government has delivered on all of these asks, and it sets set out over the course of yesterday and indeed today. That's why the government motion actually includes all of these asks from the original Labour motion as well. And let me say, a number of people have spoken, I think, quite passionately about constituency cases that have come in to them. And let me say once again, as I did yesterday, anybody who has not received the standard of service that they should have, I apologise absolutely unreservedly for that. Presiding Officer, we also heard a number of other asks at the current time this government can't support, but we will, of course, continue to look at pop-up tents to support A&E. We have real concerns about the clinical safety or the lack thereof. That's something that was mentioned by the Royal College of Emergency Medicine as well in a statement that they put out. I know there has been a lot being said by Jackie Bailey and others around mandating a 30-minute maximum turnaround time at hospitals. What I can give an absolute guarantee is that we want turnaround times to be as quick as they possibly can. We must monitor this part as part of a wider drive towards system improvement. We all want to see turnaround times as quickly as possible, but simply mandating it, of course, doesn't make it so. Of course, I'll give way to Jackie Bailey.
I'm grateful Jackie to the Bailey. Cabinet Secretary. Would he agree with me that this isn't a random request, as was suggested by Claire Adamson, but actually this came from ambulance staff themselves? This was Unite and their ambulance workers who were saying that this would be part of the solution to the problem. Would he agree with that?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I know it was an ask from Unite. I spoke to Unite yesterday, and they were welcoming of the statement that I'd made, but obviously we're pushing the government to go further, and I accept that and accept what Ms Bailey says, that she is doing this out of, I'm sure, sincerity. And I give her an absolute guarantee we want to see turnaround times at our hospitals as quickly as possible. A number of members also mentioned flow at hospitals, and rightly made the point, as I hope I reflected in my opening statement, that this is not just about the ambulance service, but a whole systems approach. And I hope that the announcement I made yesterday about almost doubling the number of HALOs, hospital ambulance liaison officers, in our hospitals, particularly at our busiest sites, and that goes back to the point that Gillian Mackay made about interventions at one of at our worst performing sites, that will hopefully help with the patient not just discharge from the ambulance, but also their flow through the hospital site in its entirety. If I may touch upon some of the other member contributions that were made, I thought Karen Mawkin spoke quite passionately about staff, and she was right. Staff don't need warm words. I'm sure they will welcome those warm words, but they need more than warm words, and that's why I'm pleased that this government has recognised our staff by making sure that they're the best paid in the UK. The recently implemented 4% pay rise being the single largest pay rise in the history of devolution. In terms of Dr. Gohani, and I should have remiss of me not to welcome him to the front bench role that he has, I also wish Annie Wells the very, very best in her recovery. My private messaging to her, I know she hopes to be back recovered and back on the front bench soon, but in her interim, in her absence, I'm sure Dr. Gohani will do a good job at the front bench. He asked a number of questions around data. I think I've answered a lot of them, but I'll take back some of the suggestions. He asked for a commitment that we will not scrap the four-hour target in terms of A&E. I give an absolute commitment and absolute assurance that we will not do that. I should say in May, of course, the UK government did intend to scrap that target. I don't know if they followed through with it, but we certainly won't be doing that. We'll be committing to that target, regardless of whatever temporary admission wards and so on are created. Gillian Mackay asked a number of questions about additional wellbeing support. Yes, that was part of the package announced yesterday. About £500,000 of the funding announced yesterday will be for targeted wellbeing. I think she makes a good point about making sure and ensuring students, second-year students, paramedic students that are helping us, particularly in control centres, aren't disadvantaged academically. That, of course, is the intention, but I will go back and look at that issue a little bit further. And she was right to make the points, as other members did, in and around social care as well. Can I say, Claire Adamson, I thought also was right. I'm not sure why members were getting so anxious about her contribution. She was right to say that, of course, these are shared challenges right across the UK. That doesn't absolve the Scottish Government from responsibility here. Not at all. That is our responsibility. That is my responsibility. But these are shared challenges. And the fact that our A&E record times are challenging, absolutely, I accept that, of course. But we are still the best performing A&E in the entire UK. So we have set out a package of £20 million additional investment for the ambulance service. I will, of course, update Parliament on our winter plan forthcoming. I am pleased to move the motion in my name, and I say that the NHS will always have this government's full and entire support.
Thank you. I call on Paul O'Kane to wind up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There can be no doubt that ambulance services, and more widely our NHS in Scotland, are in crisis. And each of us in the chamber today will have had correspondence from constituents who have told us of having to wait hours for help to come. And we've heard very powerfully a number of members speak of those today. We've seen ambulances queuing at our hospitals, and we know that waiting times at A&E are at their worst levels since records began. Tragically, people have died. And we have heard today about Susan Donald and her father from Aberdeenshire by Jackie Bailey, and indeed Gerard Brown, as we have all heard, from Glasgow, who passed away after waiting 40 hours for an ambulance. Families are brokenhearted and they are asking why, because it didn't have to happen. We've heard the calls from paramedics, doctors, nurses and healthcare staff for immediate help to support a workforce that is exhausted, undervalued and overwhelmed. Those are the words, presiding officer, of a whistleblowing paramedic who does not want to be identified because she fears for her job. She goes on to say that in all the years I have been a paramedic, I have never seen the job as bad as I do now. Of course we are living through unprecedented times. Nobody is denying that. But we know that things have been worsening for years before the pandemic. Services were struggling to keep up with demand and there was a growing backlog of care. The pandemic has exacerbated a bad situation. Or as another paramedic whistleblower based in Glasgow said, and we've heard this already, but I think it's important to hear it again, I'm fed up reading and hearing the news that the pandemic is causing the problem with delays. It's true that it's a contributing factor, but this has been a disaster in the making for years. That's not me saying this. It's not Jackie Bailey saying that. It's not any other politician saying that. It's a paramedic working on the front line. And the Cabinet Secretary and the government cannot ignore the words. And as much as James Dornan might want to make it about the staff, the hard-working staff versus opposition politicians, these words cannot be ignored. And the Cabinet Secretary must explain to hard-working staff and to bereaved families why he's been missing in action, and if you listen to this point, why he's been missing in action, as pointed out by my colleagues Jackie Bailey and Carol Mockin, until he went to the Daily Record to give that interview. The reality is that the crisis did not start 18 months ago with a global pandemic. It has been consistently building, and the warning signs have been there year after year. In 2019, we know that there was a shocking increase of 634.4% compared with 2014 in turnarounds in dealing with the availability of ambulances to respond to emergency calls. And those trends continued into 2021. And we know that last week, Unite the Union claimed that lives have been put at risk as the average 999 ambulance waiting time has increased to 6 hours across Scotland. We've heard others today in this debate speak about the problems with acute bed capacity, the problems with staffing and retention, and the problems with delayed discharge. The Scottish Government has been forced into taking remedial action to alleviate the pressures that our ambulance service is facing, as has been evidenced in the debate, and the Government is finding itself playing catch-up. Scottish Labour's priority is to give our ambulance service the urgent support it needs to save lives. And as such, we do welcome the Government's decision to request help from the Army, but the Government must go further and explore the potential of calling on recently retired ambulance staff to help during this crisis. And we must acknowledge what is being said to us by the trade unions about the Army's role and how much help that will be in terms of practical frontline roles. Scottish Labour also supports the call from Unite for the introduction of a 30-minute maximum turnaround time for ambulances from arrival at hospital, which will release paramedics to answer other calls. And the reality is, as Jackie Bailey outlined, this isn't a random request. It hasn't come, we didn't make it up. We spoke to Unite the Union, and they are representing the staff on the ground to say that that would make a real difference. In addition, temporary wards and field hospitals must be looked at, and I appreciate what the Cabinet Secretary has said, but I would ask him to work closely with the Royal College of Emergency Medicine and others to look at those options thoroughly. We also recognise the issues raised by Dr. Sandesh Gohani around reporting, and more regular reporting indeed in terms of response times. And we are in agreement that that has to happen, and I note what the Cabinet Secretary has said about improving the data that is available. And as such, we will support Dr. Gohani's amendment.
Excuse me a second, please, Mr. O'Kane. Can I ask colleagues to please not indulge in conversations in the Chamber while business is ongoing? Thank you.
We have heard a lot of chat this afternoon about warm words. And I want to just point out some of the words that have been used in the past by this government about the NHS. They say it's our most cherished public service. They said that they're going to protect and nurture it. And they've said that shorter waiting times and treatment that continues to improve is their core priority for it. Those are all quotes from SNP manifestos over the years. The reality is that patients and hard-working staff of the ambulance service and the wider NHS are facing the consequences of 14 years of government inaction on these issues. Staff are upset, they are distressed, they are angry, and they fear for the winter ahead. And that's why I want to speak about staff wellbeing, because it is fundamentally important to supporting the workforce on the front line. And I do acknowledge what the Cabinet Secretary has said around the wellbeing fund. But the reality is that there needs to go further and deeper to make a difference. The unions are telling us that. The Royal College is telling us that. The BMA yesterday told us that in committee.
Mr O'Kane, if you could please wind up.
Certainly. What we need to do is ensure, as Gillian Mackay said, that we have better support for staff who are working on the front line. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, the reality is that we must put staff and patients first. They deserve better, and I support the motion in Giacobelli's name.
Thank you. Thank you. That concludes the debate on taking action on the NHS and ambulance crisis, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business.